स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज़ डॉक्टर के सी वैयर, फैकल्टी ऑफ शांतिराम कॉलेज ऑफ फार्मेसी। एज ए पार्ट ऑफ फार्माकोएपिडेमियोलॉजिकल क्लासेस आई टेकन दी एड हॉक डेटा सोर्सेस। यू नो व्हाट एड हॉक सोर्सेस आर दी? दोज दैट आर कलेक्टेड ड्यूरिंग द पोस्ट मार्केटिंग सर्वेलेंस स्टडीज is something which is concerned with the specific purpose, that is providing data regarding drug safety in long term use, or which concern about the drug aspects in large population. So here we have to compare the post marketing studies with the pre marketing studies. So ad hoc meaning is temporary. So whatever the sources are available, both pre-marketing and post-marketing studies. You know, the pharmacoepidemiology definition is the study of use and effects of the drugs in large number of people. So where we can get that sources of data in patient? So the clinical pharmacology and epidemiology. So that's why new applied. The history of pharmacoepidemiology is an increasingly frequent occasions about adverse drug reactions often arising out of spontaneous reporting followed by formal studies proving or disproving those associations. So what are the potential contributions of pharmacoepidemiology? Pharmacoepidemiology, the study in the population, that's why. So which are the more contribution? What are potential information which supplements the information available from the pre-marketing studies? So, but that better quantification of the incidence of known adverse and beneficial effects. So, higher precision. Example of prazosin. In patient not studied prior to marketing, the elderly and children, pregnant women, as modified by other drugs and other illness, relative to other drugs used for the same indication. So, here the we have to observe the which are we can how the this higher precision may be or as modified by the other drugs and other illness. So how the patients affected from the drugs, so how the illness affecting sometimes to modify the drug, sometimes in children's, elder patients, pregnant women. So these are all the more contribution. So children's are more effective, pregnant women are more effective, more produce contributions in pharmacoepidemiological studies. So elders are more contributions when compared to normal persons. So children's, pregnant women more contribution. So new types of information not available from pre-marketing studies, discovery of previously undetected adverse and beneficial effects, uncommon effects, delay effects, pattern of drug utilization, the effects of drug overdoses, the economic implications of the drug use. So general contributions of pharmacoepidemiology is reassurances about drug safety, fulfillment of the ethical and legal obligations. So if you take in the pharmacological studies, so how you can doing the pharmacological studies? See, from the case reports we can collect, that case reports we can make as a case series. Then after that we can analysis of secular trends. So then after that we can decide either case control studies or retrospective cohort studies or prospective cohort studies or randomized clinical trials. So depending upon the subject, we can take up the studies. So in general, case reports and case series useful to suggest an association. So case reports or case series need to make a useful to suggest an association. So analysis of secular trends and case control studies useful to explore these associations. So whatever the case reports and case series to make association, so these how they can how it is explored, these analysis of secular trends and case control studies to explore the these case reports and case series. If study questions warrants investment and can tolerate the delay until results become available, then cohort studies and RCTs can be used to assess these associations more definitely. So reasons to perform pharmacoepidemiological studies. So why we have to perform the pharmacoepidemiological studies? See, here the we can get the information from the patient, either symptoms or how the drug is effectively working in the patient, or any safety measurements or any additional effects. So what is the, so these are the main reasons for the you have to do the to perform the pharmacoepidemiological studies. So how this is, first is regulatory reasons to perform this research. First, if you take a regulatory option, required, compulsory. Okay, regulation is compulsory. So to obtain earlier approval for marketing, so you have to get the approval for marketing studies as a response to question by regulatory agency. So we have to give the answer for the regulatory agency to assist the application approval for marketing elsewhere. Marketing, to assess the market penetration by documenting the safety of the drug. So we have to do the next marketing. So what are the reasons to perform the enduku manu chestunnam ante okati regulator maintain cheskovadaniki tarvata marketing le vidhanga untundanani. So here to assess the market penetration by documenting the safety of the drug, to increase the name recognition, you can get the name recognition, to assess the response, repositioning the drug. So if something, if it is the drug is not available, we can repositioning the drug. Different outcomes, example quality of life and economic, so we can get the finally different outcomes. Different types of patients we can observe, new indications we can observe, and less restrictive labeling to protect the drug from occasions about adverse effects. So these are the possibilities we can get in marketing. Next, legal. In anticipation of a future product liability litigations, in legal. So then we can observe in clinical. So first one is regulatory. Reasons to perform the pharmacological studies, we can get regulatory. So we can get the marketing, how it is the drug in marketing, and we can get the legal, and then clinical. So in clinical hypothesis testing, so what you hypothesis the first, whatever you before starting the clinical studies, hypothesis testing. So problem hypothesis on the basis of drug structure, or problem suspected on the basis of preclinical or pre-marketing human data, problem suspected on the basis of spontaneous reports. So here this is the in ad hoc studies, the spontaneous reports need to better quantitate the frequency of adverse reaction. So these are the we have to hypothesis. So how you can generate hypothesis?
needs. So if you want to do these tests, we have to generate. So needs depend on whether it is a new chemical entry. That is that whatever the you are, if you want to test that compound is a new compound, the safety profile of the class, so that drug it should be in safety profile, the relative safety of the drug within the class, the formulation, the disease to be treated, including its duration, prevalence, severity, whether alternative therapies are available. So depending upon these we can generate the, we have to make the hypothesis. Thus the decision to conduct the a pharmacological study can be viewed as a similar to the regulatory decision about the whether to approve a drug for marketing or clinical decision about whether to prescribe a drug. So in both cases, decision making involves weighing the costs and the risks of therapy against its benefits. So what are the sources of pharmacological data? What are the possibility sources? Spontaneous adverse drug effects. Global drug surveillance. So it is mainly World Health Organization and Food Drug Administration. Case control surveillance. This prescription event monitoring, automated databases and others. So these are the sources of pharmacoepidemiological data. Then if you take in spontaneous reporting, are the most common method used in pharmacovigilance in generate signals on new or rare adverse events are not discovered during clinical trials. So very useful in hypothesis generation. So for generating, so this is a test. Actually, this is a spontaneous reporting. It is unsolicited reports from the healthcare professionals or consumers. So we can get unsolicited. Manam uhinchalem. So the time. So from the healthcare, we can observe the from the consumers or healthcare professionals. So these spontaneous reports from the either voluntary or mandatory route from the healthcare professionals received by Food and Drug Administration. So these spontaneous reports are unsolicited reports from the healthcare professionals or consumers. These reports received by Food and Drug Administration, FDA. But this spontaneous report is a clinical observation that originate outside of the formal study. Nothing but here, నువ్వు ఆల్రెడీ ఫార్మేట్ చేసినటువంటి స్టడీలు ఆల్రెడీ ఒక స్టడీ జరుగుతుంటుంది. ఆ స్టడీలో కాకుండా నువ్వు ఫార్మేట్ చేసిన స్టడీ కాకుండా స్పాంటేనియస్గా బయటపడుతుంది. సో దట్ ఈస్ ఎ క్లినికల్ అబ్జర్వేషన్ దట్ ఆరిజినేట్ అవుట్ సైడ్ ఆఫ్ ఫార్మల్ స్టడీ. ద యునైటెడ్ స్టేట్స్ ఫుడ్ అండ్ డ్రగ్ అడ్మినిస్ట్రేషన్ ఈజ్ ద ఫెడరల్ పబ్లిక్ హెల్త్ ఏజెన్సీ దట్ హ్యాస్ రెగ్యులేటరీ రెస్పాన్సిబిలిటీ ఫర్ ఎన్ష్యూరింగ్ ది safety of all marketed medical products. So FDA releases on both the recognition and voluntary reporting of serious adverse effects by healthcare providers and their patients. So most injuries and deaths associated with the use of medical products results from the known side effects. So manam ekkuvaga ee spontaneous report either injuries kavachu or deaths kavachu, results from the known side effects ante manaku telisina side effects nunche vastayi. So these spontaneous effects, adverse effects, may be the known side effects. That known side effects, that known side effects, avoidable is there, unavoidable is there. అంటే ఆ స్పాయింటేనియస్ వచ్చినటువంటి సైడ్ ఎఫెక్ట్స్ మనము అవాయిడబుల్ ఉంటాయి, అన్అవాయిడబుల్ ఉంటాయి. సపోజ్ ఇఫ్ యూ టేక్ ఎన్ అన్అవాయిడబుల్, ఇట్స్ మే ప్రొడ్యూసెస్ సీరియస్ ఇంజ్యూరీ ఆర్ డెత్. అడిగిడు మీ పాయింట్. నెక్స్ట్ ఇఫ్ యూ టేక్ ఎన్ అవాయిడబుల్, సో దీస్ అవాయిడబుల్ నోన్ సైడ్ ఎఫెక్ట్స్ ఇస్ మేబీ due to because of wrong dose administration or wrong drug administration. So these are preventable adverse events. So avoidable adverse effects are preventable adverse events. So next time we cannot repeat. So these are the one known side effects. Next come to the medication errors. These medication errors, also preventable adverse effects. So medication errors ante manam teesukunna composition aina error ayyadachu, dose lo aina error ayyadachu, vaadu teesukune doses form aina error ayyadachu. So medication errors available. Next, other spontaneous reporting, how it is generated, product quality defects. So the percentage purity of the drug may be difference makes to produce the spontaneous adverse events. So these are the possibility ways we can get the spontaneous reporting adverse events. So in order to ensure that safe and effective pharmaceuticals are available, FDA releases and voluntary reporting or mandatory reporting. అంటే ఫైనల్గా రిలీజ్ చేసేది ఎఫ్డిఏ. ఇందాక చెప్పాను మీకు, ఎఫ్డిఏ రిసీవ్ చేసుకుంటుంది హెల్త్ కేర్ ప్రొఫెషన్ నుంచి, కన్జ్యూమర్స్ అంటే నథింగ్ బట్ వాలంటీర్స్ నుంచి. సో మ్యాండేటరీ రిపోర్టింగ్ ఆఫ్ అడ్వర్స్ ఎఫెక్ట్స్ బై మ్యానుఫ్యాక్చర్ యాజ్ రిక్వైర్డ్ బై లా అండ్ రెగ్యులేషన్స్. So induced spontaneous report of adverse drug reactions, medication errors and product quality problems are sent to the FDA directly. So aa vachina problems ni manam direct ga FDA ki send chestam. So indirectly combined with the data from formal clinical studies and from medical and scientific literature comprises the data, primary data source upon which post marketing and surveillance depends. So here what interview says that whatever you got clinical studies, that studies and depending upon the literature, we have to make data and we have to compare the post-market surveillance. So FDA also employs a data mining technique to identify signals previously unrecognized or unidentified serious adverse effects. So compulsory the FDA to employ the or to minimize the techniques to identify the any signals of that type. Signals ante ikkada any adverse effect, if it is that signal, it is there, they can identify. So what are the advantages of spontaneous reporting? Very wide spectrum. అంటే ఇంక్లూడ్స్ మెనీ డిఫరెంట్ అడ్వర్స్ ఎఫెక్ట్స్, ఇంట్రాక్షన్స్ అండ్ అదర్ ప్రాబ్లమ్స్ వీ కెన్ ఐడెంటిఫై, ఎఫెక్టివ్, ర్యాపిడ్ అండ్ వీ కెన్ డూ ది కంటిన్యూస్ అసెస్మెంట్ అండ్ కంపారిటివ్లీ చీప్, డస్ నాట్ రిక్వైర్డ్ మోర్ టైమ్. సో దీస్ ఆర్ ది అడ్వాంటేజెస్ ఆఫ్ స్పాంటేనియస్ రిపోర్టింగ్. The data collection of spontaneous reporting through the voluntary mandatory services is done by, already said that it is voluntary reporting or mandatory reporting, that services is done by MedWatch program. What is that? MedWatch program. The MedWatch program is for health professionals and the public to voluntarily report serious reactions and problems with the medical products, such as drugs or medical devices. Okay. So these MedWatch program, what it's do? So all data contained on the MedWatch, all data, so whatever the voluntary reporting and mandatory reporting contained on MedWatch form will be entered into the adverse event reporting system. Adverse event reporting system. Once I am repeating, the MedWatch form will be entered into the adverse event reporting system. That database main goals into whatever the adverse event reporting system, the goals are, the first is to increase awareness of drug, to increase awareness of drug or device. The second goal is MedWatch is to clarify what should be reported health professionals ante or em report chesaru. Second goal is clarify what should be reported health professional and their patients. Next, third is to make it convenient and simply to submit a report of a serious adverse effect, medical error or product quality problem directly to the FDA. Directly to the FDA. So this is the MedWatch program to make the adverse event reporting system. Adverse event reporting system. Next, a single page form is used for reporting suspected problems. Only single page. With all human use medical products regulated by the agency. Nothing but like drugs, biologicals, medical devices. So whatever it is, a single page form. After confirmation of adverse signal, FDA can initiate various regulatory actions like labeling change, such as box warning, restricted use or distribution of the drug, name or packaging changes. So the possibility ekkadaithe problem tho dan claim chesindi. So a dear healthcare professional letter, withdrawal of a medical product from the market. So, for example, signal identified via spontaneous reporting confirmed by formal pharmacological study background. So, suppose, example, I took a phenyl propylamine ingredient used in OTC, over the counter. So, and prescription cough and cold medications as a decongestant and in the OTC weight loss product. This is the background. So in 1948, FDA received reports of hematological hemorrhagic stroke, bleeding into brain or into tissue surrounding the brain in associated with propanolamine. So in addition, there were published reports in literature. Adu vachin tarvata literature published. So question, is the use of phenyl propanolamine containing a product associated with the hemorrhagic stroke? అంటే దాని నుంచి ఏమైనా ఇంట్రెస్ట్ స్ట్రోక్ వస్తుందా? దిస్ ఇస్ ద ప్రాబ్లమ్ అప్రోచ్. సో టు కన్ఫర్మ్ దిస్ సిగ్నల్, దట్ ఈజ్ సిగ్నల్. సో సిగ్నల్ అంటే ఇక్కడ జస్ట్ లైక్ ప్రాబ్లమ్. సో అండ్ అడ్హోక్ కేస్ కంట్రోల్ స్టడీ వాజ్ కండక్టెడ్. అడ్హోక్ కంట్రోల్ స్టడీ వాజ్ కండక్టెడ్. సో రిజల్ట్స్, ద స్టడీ డెమోన్స్ట్రేట్ ఈ స్టాటిస్టికల్ సిగ్నిఫికెంట్ ఇంక్రీజ్డ్ రిస్క్ ఆఫ్ హెమరోజిక్ స్ట్రోక్ అమంగ్ ది బోత్ అపిటైట్ సప్రెసెంట్ యూజర్స్ అండ్ ఫస్ట్ టైం యూజర్స్ ఆఫ్ ద డ్రగ్ ఫినైల్ ప్రొపనాలమైన్ యాజ్ ఎ కఫ్ అండ్ కోల్డ్ రెమెడీ. సో ఈ రిజల్ట్స్ సక్సెస్ అయ్యి, సో అప్పుడు తర్వాత దేని ఏం చేస్తారు, అవుట్కమ్. సో ఎఫ్డిఏ అడ్వైజర్ కమిటీ మీటింగ్ డిస్కస్డ్ ద కేస్ కంట్రోల్ స్టడీ అండ్ రికమెండెడ్ దట్ ఫినైల్ ప్రొపనాలమైన్ బీ కన్సిడర్డ్ నాట్ సేఫ్ ఫర్ ఓవర్ ది కౌంటర్ యూజ్. So the FDA then took steps to remove phenyl propanolamine from all drug products and requested all drug companies to discontinue or reformable phenylpropanolamine containing products. Like this way, we can suspect the signal. We can suspect the signal, then we have to do the study, and we can get the outcome. So thus, a formal epidemiological study is usually needed to confirm a signal identified through the spontaneous reports. That is a spontaneous report. So in spite of its limitations and under reporting, incomplete reports, etc., spontaneous reports of adverse events provide an important cornerstone for pharmacovigilance in the US. So yellow card scheme. So the UK National Spontaneous Adverse Reporting Scheme. Next, global drug surveillance. See, global reporting of concern about the suspected adverse drug reactions is a vital alerting tool. So World Health Organization headquarters in Geneva is responsible for the drug monitoring program. So it is World Health Organization operational aspects are managed by with Uppsala Monitoring Center in Sweden. So according to the agreement signed between the World Health Organization and Sweden in 1978, only regular budget contribution the center is providing by the Swedish government. In each country participating in the World Health Organization program, there is a national center appointed by the government responsible for the collecting spontaneous reported suspicious adverse reactions from the healthcare professionals. National centers transfer their case reports into specific World Health Organization format and submit them to the Uppsala Monitoring Center on a regular basis. So the World Health Organization like that way to monitoring the drugs. So is a World Health Organization is a collaborating center for international drug monitoring in Uppsala. So today 73 countries full official members, 12 countries associate members. So national centers should be reporting ATMIN and whatever the spontaneous case reports reporting monthly frequency. So recently there has been an international effort to harmonize the term used to describe the adverse events and to set criteria and definitions for at least the major serious types of reactions. To harmonize the way data are stored and communicated internationally, the main agency involved in this are World Health Organization, International Harmonization, so other. So the medical dictionary for regulatory activities is being used more and more worldwide. Also, international conference harmonization is a format which is a guidelines for the transmission format for the information to be included and adverse drug reactions case report is being used. Next, another way to get the source is a case control surveillance. So like prescription drugs, non-prescription drugs can also have serious adverse effects, unintended benefits. So drugs previously available in prescription being approved for the over-the-counter sales. So case control surveillance or multiple case control studies are conducted simultaneously in order to monitor the effects of prescription and over-the-counter medications and dietary supplements and risk of various illness. You know already how the case control studies you observed so many. So case control release on self reports of medication and dietary supplement use. So ask about 43 indications or medication categories. So strength. So case control, so in the, if you take and observe the strength, what is the strength of the case control study? So it has the capacity to monitor prescription drugs, potentially important confounders, over the counter drugs and dietary supplements. Next, can have high statistical power because the large number of cases occur. But case control surveillance lo manaku main entante large number of population ఉంటుంది. So large number of cases వస్తాయి కాబట్టి దాని స్టాటిస్టిక్ పవర్ కూడా ఇంక్రీజ్ అవుతుంది, ద ప్రాబిలిటీ కూడా ఇంక్రీజ్ అవుతుంది. సో యాజ్ అ కేస్ కంట్రోల్ స్టడీస్ ఒప్టైన్ డేటా ఆన్ మెనీ ఎక్స్పోజర్స్ అండ్ మెనీ అవుట్కమ్స్, ఇట్ హ్యాస్ అ కెపాసిటీ టు డిస్కవర్ అన్ఎక్స్పెక్టెడ్ అసోసియేషన్స్. ఎగ్జాంపుల్ ఇన్వర్స్ అసోసియేషన్ బిట్వీన్ ఆస్పిరిన్ అండ్ రిస్క్ ఆఫ్ colorectal cancer was documented in a case control study, case control surveillance. Actually the aspirin you can give the for the anti-inflammatory and antipyretic, also some colon diseases, but it is a risk. Colorectal cancer sometimes was documented in it is spontaneous developed, that's why. So this is one type of case control surveillance. So publication provoked many subsequent studies which confirmed the association. Assessment of effects after long intervals or duration of use. Example, adverse effects of estrogen supplements and risk of endometrial cancer persisted for 15 to 19 years after cessation of use. You get my point. Estrogen supplements are risk endometrial cancer. Estrogen, but it is 15-19 years after cessation of use. So allow for assessment of whether genetic polymorphism modify the effect of medication or supplement and the risk of the illness. So what are the limitations is a potential for selection of bias and the call bias. But you can give it some bias in this program. So next comes to the prescription event monitoring. In this we can observe the some adverse effects in the prescription. So in which cohort of users of medicine is defined from prescription and followed up for a defined period from 6 to 12 months to identify all adverse events occurring in the early post treatment period. So the limitation contributions of spontaneous adverse reaction reporting system in the detecting hazards such as oculomucocutaneous syndrome with practolol led in man to establish the system of prescription event monitoring at the drug safety research unit at Southampton in 1981. So it is one form of pharmacovigilance and is complementary to spontaneous reporting of suspected adverse drug reactions. So from the prescription based. So method of both hypothesis generation and testing. See, notify the that a new drug to be established, new to be studied, patient take prescription to the pharmacist. So pharmacist dispense drug and forwards prescription to a prescription. So this is prescription event. So for reimbursement purpose. Then after that sends prescription data to. So once I am repeating, the drug safety research unit. Drug safety research unit notifies the pharmaceutical product development of a new drug to be studied. Pharmaceutical product development. If the patient takes prescription to pharmacist, the pharmacist dispenses a drug and forwards the prescription to pharmaceutical product analyst for reimbursement purpose. Then pharmaceutical product as a analyst sends prescription data to drug safety research unit to strict confidence. Then drug safety research unit sends the questionnaire to good laboratory practice. Then GP returns a questionnaire to drug safety research unit to scan it and review it. So data from questionnaire entered to DSRG database. So follow up the selected events question on the basis of a questionnaire sent to GP. Then pregnancy is a questionnaire sent to GP for outcome and deaths cause of death. So these are the way of how prescription. So this is a drug safety research unit prescription event monitoring. So medical in conference. So how they are doing, World Health Organization prescribed, what which one, how it is regulated. So there is a growing use of computerized database containing medical care data called automated database, which are a potential data source for the pharmacoeconomic study. So clients database and medical recorded database, both are, it will be important. These are automatically regulated. So advantages provide a very large sample size, so uncommon outcomes can be detected, provide demonitor and needed to calculate incidence rate. Next, relatively inexpensive to use because the studies using these databases do not need to incur the cost of data collection. No opportunity for a recall or interior bias. So when time is limited, when budget is limited. So other sources of data is drug utilizing data, disease incidence data, adverse control case control studies, register data, pharmacy based post marketing service studies. So these are all comes. So thank you students. So this is the regarding for the pharmacoeconomics ad hoc data sources. Make it notes. Thank you.